I did this morning when I observed your life mystical insights. Relationship the mirror. Relationship the mirror, an excerpt from life the mystical insights. Indeed, relationship is the mirror. In the process of relating the others, the other becomes a mirror. And when you look into the mirror of relationship, you can really see how far you have progressed in waiting. Why is it so difficult then? Why do people tend to move out of relationships so easily or avoid it rightly? Why do people tend to move out of relationships so easily or avoid it outrightly? This is what is being explained in relationship the mirror. When you are interacting with someone at any level, be it physical, be it a discussion, you remember as an individual you are nothing else but a crystallized ego. When you say something, you expect that your views to be respected, irrespective of whether the views fit in that framework or not. And then when we enter into a love relation as we understand, and that too without awareness, without meditativeness, it creates problem. You have to understand the very nature of the relationship. Also, there is a way to relate. We tend to give too much importance to relationships than to the way of relating. Relating is most significant. Relating is a goal, and relationship is a noun. You cannot change noun. You are you and I am I. How can you change in a particular circumstance or situation? I am engaging in a conversation with you. I will not be able to change at that moment, neither my appearance nor anything else. The only thing that will change my strategies and my way of it, relating to you. And it can be done very frequently also. This is the thing. If you realize that while you are talking to someone and you are aware of the expressions arising on the face of the person, you can change the course of your thoughts. If you feel from the expression of on the face of the person that he is not understanding this particular view of yours, you can immediately change the strategy, bring a new perspective, a new way to understand, new way to explain. Because the process of relating can be changed. And this is what is significant, that we have to learn the art of relating to people. We have to respect. Yesterday, day before yesterday it happened, I called the Indian High Commissioner to invite him for the launch of Gitandhar Sadhana Journey. He asked me one question. Now listen to this question. He asked me if I am inviting dignitaries. I did not mention the name of the person whom I am inviting. The status he emphasized. I told him, for me, the aspirants, the devotees are the dignitaries. They are most significant because a change can be brought into them. And this forum where we are releasing the journal of Gita Dharma Sadhana, the most important person for this is Yogeshwar Krishna and Arjuna. It is a dialogue between the two. They are at the helm of the affairs. I am simply relating the process to connect so that you can listen to that silent communion that happened between Sri Krishna and Arjuna. Energy cannot be destroyed. The message of Krishna is still echoes in the atmosphere. It is only we do not have the inner capabilities to connect. And not only the message of Krishna, but the message of all the masters. Whatever Jesus spoke to Nicodemus, or for that matter to others, if you are introspective and meditative, you can feel the intensity, the energy field. You can feel the subtle nuances how Jesus would have spoken to Nicodemus. And you can connect to the same energy field when these words were spoken for the first time. This is Nispat. And to connect to the Nispat, the we. To connect to the Nispat is the tarika, the methodology. That is what is being discussed. A minister is a status, a position that the person holds. That position cannot be transformed, but the individual can be transformed. And what happens? The ego becomes so complex and crystallized that the ego of a politician cannot be sublimated. It becomes very difficult for a politician to be an aspect. Politics is a game of power, and to be an aspirant, you have to drop all these. To have a communion with Krishna or with Jesus or with Lao Tse, you have to be completely free of these encumbrances. You have to go to him as the one who does not know, who needs to know, who aspires to know. But a minister comes to teach you. And for me, and I told him that you will recollect the conversation. Once Buddha was in commune, and it happened that the king of the time, Prasannaji, came to the commune of Buddha. Normally the ministers expect a particular type of dignitaries, expect a particular type of reception given to them when they arrive. Buddha remained continued because he is in the higher commune. He is bringing out the message for the transformation of the human consciousness. Buddha did not get up from his seat. or pay any attention, and for that matter nobody paid any attention to the king. His ego was hurt. He had already come, because Buddha was a recognized master of the time, and he was very restless. How can he listen? So when you are speaking to someone, you are relating. This relation, the way of relating, has to be overflowing out of your lovingness. Not that you are doing a favor to the other. The other is doing a favor by listening to you. The other is doing a favor by listening to you. Appreciative of all the contributions that has come to the journal. Because this is the way people will grow into awareness. When they have to contribute something or write, they will explore. They will explore the subject matter, knowing that the subject matter must flow with the magazine, with the journal. Not that in that journal which is on Gita Dhyan Sadhana you talk about love making. It does not fit in there. When you are preparing an East Indian feast, you have to have the complimentary menu. The meal planning has to be complimentary. That does not mean that I am not capable of doing it. I do not need any assistance from anyone. When it comes to these journals, but if I do not give opportunity to the others, then I will be failing in my role of a Buddha. It is by applying yourself you will learn the art, and in learning the art you will grow into awareness, and which is the main purpose behind it. So when it is coming to the relationship, you have to learn the ways and means, the nuances, feeling the sensitivity of the person whom you are married, whom you are speaking to. But at the same time you have not forgotten your purpose, what you are. You are here for a specific purpose. Yesterday someone had sent me a message, and that is very beautiful. Meri jeevan yatra anant hai. My life's journey is infinite. Anant means eternal, infinite. Meri jeevan yatra anant hai. My life's journey is infinite. Kabhi ye kabhi anant mein chalti rahi hai. Sometimes it traveled within the infinite realm, or kabhi anant ke saath chalti rahi hai. Sometimes it has traveled hand in hand with the infinite. Is anant ki sugandh aur roshni sabke saath baantne ke liye main yahan, ke liye hi main yahan, to share the fragrance and the light of infinite. I am here to share the fragrance and light of the infinite. I am here. It's a beautiful lines written in Hindi. And another composition was "My thoughts were erratic for nights, and the moment thoughts held on to realization, there was an echo in the heart that became the fulfillment and dissolved in my every breath. My body attained, took a yawn and embraced consciousness. Since then, there is the dancing well of the uncreated sound in my feet, and it started, I started listening to the unheard sound as I walk through the temple doors. The body has become the temple, filled with the light of witnessing, and in that even the god of the temple has dissolved." This was a beautiful composition in Hindi. It has not been translated yet, still I spoke it message. Relating is the outcome of meditation. When someone attains to meditation, he learns the art of relating. Relationship is indeed the mirror of one's inward growth. Relating is the meditative way of living. You see people around claiming to be meditators, but when you look into their eyes, there is no bliss overflowing. Either through their living or through their words. This is a sad fact. Hardly ever you really see someone who is emotionally mature. Relationship gives you emotional maturity. Relationship gives you emotional maturity. Then when you begin to relate or enter into any relationship, they always remain the fear of commitment. And it is because of this that all problems arise in life. You find yourself incapable of making a decision. Remember, it is only through decision that you attain to consciousness. And when you take the responsibility of your decisions and stand by those, that you become more and more conscious. In this process, you attain to crystallization. This brings sharpness and maturity as well. In the absence, you remain nothing. When you look around, you will observe people moving from one master to another, and people move from one temple to another. People move from one relationship to another. This does not mean that these people are really seekers or they are true lovers. It is so because such people are incapable of making decisions. And this is the way to avoid commitment. Something like this happens when you come to human relations as well, human relationships as well. You go on moving from one person to another, and you think that you are really a great lover. This simply indicates that you are not a lover indeed. In fact, you are really avoiding the deep commitment. Commitment has good points and bad points. It brings moments of ecstasy and moments of despair and agony. If you avoid pain, you will not gain the ecstasy, the blessings, the bliss of it. What really happens with commitment is that there comes a deep involvement, and also the problem relating to this. In this process, you have to face problems and also the pain associated with it. So you try to play safe, and this you do by not going deep into it with anyone. There remains a fear that if you go deep, you may not be able to come out of the relationship. Whatever be the nature of relationship, be it worldly or beyond, you never go deeper into it. You want to remain on the surface. On the surface, you only see the duality, the conflict, the abandon, the pain, the superfluous. You can stand on the seashore and say that you have been in the ocean. On the surface, you only see the waves. Neither the waves, neither is the ocean, nor the sum total of all the waves is ocean. Waves arise on the surface of the ocean. Waves are multiple, and ocean is one. In order to know truth, you have to dive deep into the womb of the ocean. There lies the treasures. So too, on the surface of relationship, you see only the superfluous, the ego, the pain, and things like this. To discover truth, you have to dive deep into the relationship. The fear of commitment, problems, hurt, etc. keep you away from going deeper into any relationship and thus discovering the inner treasure of serenity, bliss, ecstasy and oneness. All that keep you away from going deeper is your ego. Such an experience is what you call as God realization or self-realization. In fact, it is wrong to call it a relationship or experience, but mystics are always in difficulty. What they want to communicate is beyond words. It is wordless, it is the unheard, the uncreated sound. But in order to explain that, we have to use the sound. We have to use the sound of the gaps. And words are incapable to encompass all that is. Because all that is really magnanimous. Beyond words, Hindus call this as Anhatna of the uncreated sound. If you go deep into any relation, then there is a fear that you may not come back. And if you go deep into somebody, then that person will also go deeper into you. Such a phenomenon is proportionate. Because if I really go deep into you, this is the way that allows you to go deep into me as well. It is a deep sharing. Meditation is deep sharing with your being. A master is a deep communion with the being, and he shares that moments of uncreated sound. Because unless the word can create or connect you to your inner silence or create in you an experience of the unheard, It is not meditation. It is not commune. When Jesus used to commune, he may be using the words, but in that his silence is being communicated, his peace is being communicated, his awareness is being communicated. And when it becomes part of you, it brings tremendous understanding, blissfulness and blessedness, and it is in that the transformation happens. You remember when the elite, the respectable, brought this woman onto the master. The master was sitting with his head cast, looking on the sand on the ground. This woman is found into adultery. What do you say, master? The old religion says that this woman should be stoned to death. What do you say, master? They are putting the master into a devil. He is the bridge between the old and the new. He is bringing the people who were the followers of Moses into the new. The old religion said that such a woman should be stoned to death because she is found in adultery. Jesus did not raise his head. This is the nuance that only an enlightened man can know. Jesus, if he had looked into the eyes of Mary Magdalene, he would have created a guilt feeling that you do consider me to be guilty. What is my fault? Who is the one to lead me into this adultery? It is the elite who has led me. First time it always happens that under a certain circumstance and situation this happens. Then the society does not accept the person. The ordinary livelihood becomes difficult. Then the person by force and has to enter into what they call adultery. A master of compassion, Jesus does not look into her eyes. He simply, with his head downcast, he said, indeed it is written in the old religion that a woman who is found in adultery should be stoned to death. But only the person who has not been a victim of adultery should cast the first stone. It is also written that those who have entered into adultery have no right to cast a stone. Jesus has brought you to the other shore of awareness. Who are responsible for this woman to enter into adultery? Your society, your elite, your people. And when the person enters into the same elite are raising the eyebrows, slowly and slowly the crowd disappeared. There remained the woman who was brought and the master. Then for the first time Jesus looks into her eyes and says, woman, sin no more, go home. Have you felt the intensity of these words of the Lord of compassion? Woman, Sin no more. Go home. These words and the unheard energy field that flows behind these words is the very insignia of the enlightened. And it is this that has the capacity to transform the human beings. Can you imagine the state of Mary Magdalene then? Feel that time you are the Mary Magdalene. And these words were spoken to you. Can you speak these words that Jesus spoke with that intensity, and the words will have that effect on the minds of the listener? Only then you can bring about a transformation. This is what Tulsidas has said, those who listen, those who get fed up listening to the portraits of the masters, they have not explored the inner essence of the masters. Although he has spoken only of Sri Rama, but that applies to all the enlightened. For you, Jesus should be as important as Ram, as Krishna, as Charitrus, as Lao Tse is. Because they all have experienced this deep within this. And it is that manifest. The fear remains that this can entangle you and will certainly entangle you. This brings pain. So you want to play safe. This you do by meeting on the surface alone. All your so-called relationships are superfluous and remain on the surface. Husbands and wives may remain for a long time together, maybe 15, 60 years together, and they see that there is too much love, but in reality it is not love. What actually happens when two people stick together for some time, togetherness happens, and this is very easy to be mistaken for love. Love is the shadow of meditation. Remember this. Love is the shadow of meditation. When meditation happens, there comes the experience of inner oneness. The anima and animus, the yin and yang in you, merge into one another. As the fragrance of meditation, as the fragrance of this merger of yin and yang, as the harmony between anima and animus, love springs forth. Such phenomena is rarely seen. What you would really see around is meeting of two bodies, neither the two souls nor emptiness. Such are hit and run. Love fears. You tend to run before you are caught. This is what you see around. People have become so juvenile and childish that they are losing all sense of maturity. By maturity I do not mean physical maturity. I mean inner or spiritual maturity. The maturity that comes with the merger of anima and animus. The maturity that comes when yin and yang neutralize one another and the light manifests, and that light is love. The light that manifests when yin and yang neutralize one another, when animal and animals merge into one another. I mean inner or spiritual maturity. Maturity comes when you are ready to face the pain of your being. Maturity comes when you are ready to face the challenge. And remember, there is no greater challenge than love. Remember to live happily with, another person is the greatest challenge in the world. Remember to live happily with another person, the collected, harmonious within, is the greatest challenge in the world. You can live peacefully alone. It is very easy. However, it is difficult to live peacefully, joyfully and meditatively with another person. More so when someone else is your wife or husband, it becomes almost impossible. Almost impossible. What happens then is that now two ego collide. Two worlds collide, two expectations collide, and it is also the explosion of two differently understood worlds. Then how can the two opposite poles meet? How can the two be attracted to one another? They are totally different, almost opposite. In the polar opposites, then the meeting happens only on the surface, and there is no question of the merger of the two worlds, two egos. Two worlds, two souls can merge only when the egos dissolve. This is the first criteria of relating. Therefore, it is difficult to be peaceful and loving in a relationship, because that is a challenge. And if you accept from that, if you escape from that, you escape from maturity. If you go into it with all the pain, agony, and all that a relationship brings, and still continue delving deeper and deeper into it, then by and by, the pain becomes a blessing. The conflict becomes a synergistic harmony, and by, through the conflict and friction, crystallization happens. Through the struggle, we become more alert and more aware. This is the role of Krishna in the lives of the mankind. This is the role that Krishna is creating, the meditative inner zone of no war, conflict in the minds of the milkmaids and the cowherd boys. Krishna does not need any physical relation with those. At any other time, I will explain this aspect of Krishna. The other becomes like a mirror to you. You can see your ugliness in the other. The other provokes your unconscious, brings it to the surface. Then it is for you to go into silence. And into your meditativeness, so you can remove those ugly spots from your face. When you look into the mirror, you see the face has ugly spots. You use the facial creams or some other accessories. Meditation is the accessories for changing the innerness. And when you are aware, then you continue to grow in maturity. And what then happens? No words can encompass the magnanimity of it. It is like a dove has now tasted the sweet fruit. He cannot describe the taste. Only through his silent gestures he can speak of inner happiness. The taste that he has tasted, this I call, you can only come to know all the hidden parts of your being through the mirror of relationship. You can know how deeply you are into yourself, how deeply you are connected to your being, how collected you are, how much you have grown into awareness. You can only come to know all hidden parts of your being through the relationship, through the mirror of relationship. These are to be mirrored, reflected in a relationship, and then connected, meditated. This I call Isya, because there is no other way. And it is hard. It is hard and arduous, because you will have to change through it. And when you break the mirror, how can there be a reflection of the hidden parts of your being, your ugliness, your ego, etc.? And when these are not reflected, there is no way to improve or let inner beauty to manifest. There is an anecdote in the life of Zivunisa. She was the sister of the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. When there was mutiny, Aurangzeb publicly killed all his brothers who were the elder to him and who had the right over the kingdom, and imprisoned his father. But he did not do anything to his sister Zivunisa. Zivunisa was very ugly but very spiritual, and she was a woman of awareness. She had a mirror, and that time mirror was a luxury because it used to come from China. It was luxury means that it was not within the reach of the ordinary people. And it happened that while working or cleaning, the mirror fell from the hands of the maid and broke. She was afraid of the punishment, but she told Zivunisa, and Zivunisa said that the mirror is broken. It is good in me. Now I cannot see my ugly face. So if you break the mirror of relationship, how can you see your ugliness? How can you, when you see your face, and normally every woman carries a small mirror in her handbag, and now these cosmetic people have become so aware of this fact that along with the face powder or the compact powder, they have the mirror on the other side. So when you look into the mirror, you will definitely find some spots on your face not looking suitable for the occasion, so you will take a puff of the compact powder and paste it on your that spot. So two things are done. Very intelligent marketing strategy to sell their compact powder. When somebody is traveling, how can they use the compact powder and how can they repeat the order or buy a new one? They give a waiver. When a female worker comes out of the office, before she leaves, she first opens her bag, opens the compact powder pack, looks at the face in the mirror, takes a puff here and a puff there. She is now ready to do marketing strategies. And when you break the mirror, how can there be the reflection of the hidden parts of your being, your ugliness, your ego, etc. And when these are not reflected, there is no way to improve or let the inner beauty to manifest. So too, when you come to a university, there comes an even greater challenge before you, because then you have to decide quickly. The problem is greater because you have to choose. You have to choose the unknown and unknown. Also, your decision has to be total and absolute. This is not a child's game. And once you have made a decision, there is no return. This brings so much conflict. So the easiest way is not to go on changing continuously. This is the way to avoid yourself, and you will remain soft, babyish, and maturity will not happen to you. Only the unknown and unknowable should have a call for you, because that you have not yet lived. You have not moved in that end. Move, something new will definitely happen. Then only your silent gestures will speak of inner bliss. Therefore, O fool, always go to the unknown, whatever be the risk, whatever be the outcome, and you will grow continuously. But in all circumstances, you choose the unknown, and then you move in a continuous circle, with the past again and again coming to the surface. You go on repeating it, and in the process you have become a compact disc that is moving in a repeat mode. So you think through it and decide. The sooner you can do so, the better. Postponement is really stupid. Tomorrow you will also have to decide. So why not now? And now is the precise moment. And you think that tomorrow you will be wiser than today? Do you think tomorrow you will be livelier than today? Do you think that tomorrow you will be younger than today or fresher than today? Will tomorrow ever come? Firstly, tomorrow never comes. And tomorrow you will be older, you will be less courageous, and there will be depletion of energy. But you go on thinking that tomorrow you will be more experienced. Indeed, you will be more cunning. As time moves, you are coming closer to death. The wheel of time is moving, and soon frigid claws of death will descend and seal your humble fate. Then you shall have time to wait. And then you will start weaving with more faith. Never postpone for tomorrow, and who knows, tomorrow may come or may not come. If you have to decide, you have to decide right now. Because transformation can only happen now and here. Not tomorrow, not in the distant future. Tomorrow, transformation can happen only this very moment. Only this much for this talk. on relationship in mirror. Only this much for this morning. Take care and do have a pleasant day.